So good evening and welcome to the Maison Française for this celebration of a new book by my colleague Souleymane Bachir Diagne. So the book is an English translation of L'encre des savants, Réflexion sur la philosophie en Afrique. The original French version was published in 2013 simultaneously by Présence Africaine in Paris and Codrecia in Dakar, in this joint publication in Paris and Senegal is a very important aspect of the book. It has been translated now into English by Jonathan Ajemian and published again under the auspices of Codrecia, that is to say, the Conseil pour le développement de la recherche en sciences sociales en Afrique. So as you can see, it is a slim volume, but it covers a lot of ground. It's in its thinking about philosophy in, from, and about Africa. The book performs a really brilliant and elegant synthesis of the question of philosophy in, from, and about Africa, focusing on four central questions. The question of the role of vital forces, the concept of vital forces in African thought, the question of temporality in African thought, the question of the interplay between orality and literature, and finally, a reflection on political philosophy in Africa from the various socialisms of the era of independence to more recent thinking about democracy and human rights. It would be, I think, an understatement to say that this book is timely. The title, L'encre des savants, is drawn from a saying of the Prophet Muhammad, who says that the ink of the scholars is more precious than the blood of the martyrs. And this saying is one that holds a central place in the work On the Merits of Scholars, written by Ahmed Baba, who was perhaps the most famous and important scholar from Timbuktu, so a scholar from the 16th and 17th century. And as you know, of course, Timbuktu and its institutions of learning came under attack in 2012-2013 in the name of Islam. So Bashir's book can be read, among other things, as a reflection, as a response to these attacks on learning in Africa. So it gives me a great deal of pleasure to introduce Bashir, as well as Gary Wilder, who will be responding to Bashir, and they'll both be discussing the book. So Bashir Diagne, Souleymane Bachir Diagne, is professor of French and philosophy and chair of the French department here at Columbia. He is a true polymath, whose fields of research include the history of logic and mathematics, Islamic philosophy and literature. He is a prolific scholar. His many books include Boule, l'oiseau de nuit en plein jour, Comment philosopher en Islam, Islam et société ouverte, La fidélité et le mouvement dans la pensée de Mohamed Iqbal, African Artist Philosophy, Senghor, Bergson and the Idea of Negritude, and Bergson Postcolonial, L'élan vital dans la pensée de Léopold Sédar Senghor et de Mohamed Iqbal. He won in 2011, for this last work that I mentioned, the Daniel Bouvray Prize of the French Academy of Moral and Political Sciences. In the same year, he also won the Prix Édouard Glissant, which is given to a scholar whose work reflects Glissant's own values of promotion of North-South exchange and dialogue and cultural diversity. He was, among many other honors and forms of recognition, listed last year in an editorial in Le Monde as one of the 10 African thinkers who are ready to complete the emancipation of the continent of Africa. No pressure. I'm also delighted to introduce our colleague Gary Wilder, who is Professor of Anthropology, History and French, and the Director of the Committee on Globalization and Social Change at the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. Gary Wilder is the author of Freedom Time, Negritude, Decolonization, and the Future of the World, and an earlier book, The French Imperial Nation State, Negritude and Colonial Humanism Between the World Wars. He's currently co-editing a volume with Ginny Kim Watson entitled The Postcolonial Contemporary, which is going to come out with Fordham Press. And he's also working on a book provisionally entitled Cooperative Commonwealth, Radical Humanism, and Black Atlantic Criticism. And I think it's safe to say that Gary Wilder is the perfect person. There could be no one better to comment on Bachir's book this evening. So without further ado, I will hand over to Bachir, who will, I think, give us a broader context for this book, and then to Gary, who'll make some comments, and then there'll be time for us all to discuss.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Madeleine. Thank you for chairing this session. I would like to thank the Heyman Center and Eileen for putting this event together. I'm very honored and grateful that you are celebrating this book of mine, which has had this afterlife, as Benjamin says, through its translation into English. And I would thank also Shani and Maison Francaise for hosting and organizing, co-organizing, co-sponsoring this event. And thank you very much, Madeleine, for just being this wonderful colleague. And I could not hope, I could not have had a better colleague to introduce me. Gary and I go way back, and we share to have worked on Leopold Sédar Senghor, in particular the Negritude authors, and we share to have called for a rereading, let's say, of Senghor and Negritude writers. So I'm very happy that Gary, you could make it and accept to discuss my book. You can feel in the trembling of my voice how overwhelmed I am, truly, to see so many friends here. And I thank you all. As we say in my language in Wolof, I thank each and any of you by his first name and his surname. That is a way of saying that, looking, I recognize the beard of a friend here, the blonde hair of another friend there, and I see that, and I thank you all for being here. I was hesitating on the best way to say a few words about my book, and the best way to do that is to talk about the very expression African philosophy, which is what I'm going to do in the next few minutes. In 1978, I was taking a test in France, which is called aggregation. It's a very French thing. You never recover from taking those kind of tests. And I was thinking, okay, what am I going to do as next if I succeed for my dissertation? I had the feeling that being an African with all the many problems on my continent, I had some mission to tackle what I would call the philosophical problems of Africa, which was just a big phrase. I'm not sure it had a denotation. And then I read a book written by someone whom I came to know afterwards. His name is Paulin Huntongji, a Beninese philosopher. And the book was titled On African Philosophy. And basically what he was saying is that there is not such a thing as African philosophy. There is a philosophy produced by authors who happen to be Africans. And I thought, thanks God, I don't have to take care of of Africa, I can do what I was planning to do, which is work on the algebra of logic and the encounter between mathematics and logic without having the feeling that I was betraying any kind of mission. And then something happened which we call life. Mm-hmm. And life means that I decided not to stay in France after finishing my different degrees there. I thought that I had to go back home. And going back home meant that you would precisely be working on those philosophical problems. Unless you decide that you are going to be in your ivory tower dealing with Leibniz and Boole and ignoring what was happening around you, the kind of debates that were taking place, you could not just ignore this very expression, African philosophy. So what is it? What is behind that expression and what are the controversies? One could say that the very expression itself appeared in after World War II under the pen of this Belgian missionary named Placide Tempels, who wrote a book titled Bantu Philosophy. That was the first time there was an association between Africa and philosophy. Tempels had traveled to present-day Congo and with the mission of doing what missionaries do, which is evangelize and try to convert people. In order to do that, he learned the languages of the people among whom he was going to live, and learned about their customs, their proverbs, their institutions, their art, their religion, of course. And during the war, he wrote this book first in Flemish, which was his native tongue, and in which he declared that he was looking at not an anthropological or ethnological description of the Bantu people among whom he was living, but he was trying to reach beyond the surface that is what anthropology or ethnology reaches, the very philosophical postulates upon which the rest rested. In other words, he was looking for a set of philosophical ontological postulates upon which he thought that Bantu institutions, Bantu arts, or Bantu religions rested. And he said that this is philosophical work and not ethnological work. That philosophy for him went deeper than ethnology and came first chronologically and logically. So the question he posed is, what is being for the people among whom I'm living? And to this question, for him, Bantu people responds, being is force. Not that being is characterized by force or has force, but being is the same thing as force. It is, force is not predicated of being. It constitutes the meaning of being. So this is the first of a series of ontological postulates or axioms that Placide Temple thought he had identified that explained the language of the Bantus and their different institutions and behaviors and customs, etc. The second being, each force is individual. Third, forces exert an action upon each other, upon one another. Force, the universe is a network of forces running from the force of forces down to the mineral by way of the noble dead, those called the ancestors, the living person, the animals, the plants, etc. Something that is described usually by ethnologists as animism. Fifth postulate, a force's goal is to increase. The purpose of a force is to become more force. So what augments a force is good, and what diminishes it is bad. These are the fundamentals of what Father Temples considered to be the dynamic ontology that Bantu culture and Bantu languages carried within themselves, according to him. And he opposed that view to what he considered a static ontology in the Aristotelian tradition, where you have a subject or a substratum which is itself unchanging and receives from outside predicates that are attributed to it. When that book was translated into French from Flemish right at the end of the war by Présence Africaine, this publishing house in Paris, in the heart of the Quartier Latin, the book was a resounding success. In fact, Présence Africaine was literally created to publish this book, because before that it was just a journal. And the founder of Présence Africaine, Alun Diop, indicated to the preface he wrote to Bantu philosophy that this was, with Jean-Paul Sartre's Black Orpheus, the most important book on Africa that he had read. And particularly important for Alun Diop was that in showing the functioning of an ontology of vital force in the different spheres of Bantu social life, the book by Placide Temples was somehow reclaiming the notion of vital force from the murderous use that Nazism had made of it, restoring it to its meaning, or what should be its meaning, as a joyful celebration of the power of existing. To understand the success of Temple's book, which was welcomed as a foundational event by figures as diverse as the Senegalese Léopold Sédar Senghor or Cheikhanta Diop or the French philosopher Gaston Bachelard, requires understanding the rupture the book represented with the long-held view of Africa as a land of wrapped in the mantle of night, as Hegel famously said. So with that book, a genre, a literary genre, was born. And into the 1970s, from the 1950s into the 1970s, a series of studies on the philosophy in Africa, on philosophy in Africa, were published, all of them modeled after Bantu philosophy. So you would have books on Yoruba philosophy, Igbo philosophy, or Akan philosophy, or the moral philosophy of the Wolof, and so on, so forth. Now, this is a place to say a few words on the important place occupied in philosophy by African art. In fact, the reason why Senghor, whom I mentioned earlier, loved this book is that he found that the best evidence for what Placide Temples was saying was African art. He read in the series, in the system founded on upon the postulates that I have recalled from the book, he found the real explanation or the good reading of what African art is, what l'art nègre, as it was termed in the beginning of the 20th century, was. So to say that the arts of the continent, the visual arts in particular, constitute the best proof of this philosophy of vital force is to say that it provides a hermeneutical key to read creations that are characterized in spite of the differences between the diverse cultures and regions from which they come. By now, especially in this university, we know that Africa is not a country. It is a huge continent with differences and so on. But in spite of all these differences, you have this common denominator of African art, which is this extreme stylization and geometrization of forms and a rejection of naturalism concerning, for example, the proportions of the human body. Put briefly, the work of art does not represent, it symbolizes. And what it symbolizes and manifests, says Senghor, for instance, is being force, being hyphen force, become rhythm. The creation of the art object, like its perception takes place in what the Senegalese poet and philosopher calls a rhythmic attitude that dances together with the object being produced. And it is not by chance, by the way, that the sculptures that are carved by the Makonde people in Mozambique, and I thank my student and colleague, Alvaro, who has called first my attention to those sculptures. So the sculptures they call Ujamaa, which present superimposed motif and human figures and are called trees of life. In sculptures in which, for example, an old man's head is disproportionately large in comparison to the infant's body that carries it, we are invited to see, apercevoir, says Senghor, in the disproportion that we initially perceive, the sub-reality that the object manifests, which would be, in this case, the continuous cycle of life force where the ancestors have the vigor and youth that childhood promises, and where newborns are close to the ancients whose existence they reproduce. That can be read in this kind of sculpture. Now, one question which could be posed, as I said, temples had opened the gate for these kind of studies. The question that was posed sometime in the middle of the 1970s was to say, well, wait a minute. Can we really say that philosophy is the expression of a culture? That Bantu philosophy is the expression of Bantu culture? Isn't philosophy, on the contrary, a way of distancing oneself from precisely culture? That would be the gesture of our philosopher ancestor, Socrates, breaking away from Athens culture, and that is the reason why he's condemned by that same Athens. And along those lines, the book and people who thought in that following Temple's model were attacked by a younger generation of philosopher who actually claimed that they were continuing the criticism of Aimé Césaire against the book. But if we read what Aimé Césaire said about Bantu philosophy, Aimé Césaire never criticized the book itself. He dismissed it. It actually, what he says, what Aimé Césaire writes, is to say, well, why is this Belgian missionary so interested in the soul of the Bantus? These Bantus are not interested in putting their soul in display or showing their ontology. They are asking for better wages. They are asking for better conditions of work. They are unionizing and rioting. And ultimately, what they want is their independence. So that explains the difference between Césaire and Senghor. When people say that Senghor loved the book and Césaire hated it, Césaire did hate it, but he hated the very idea and the preface of the book. He never talked about the content of it, while Senghor was interested for the artistic, aesthetic reasons that I have explained in the content of the book. So, that was the criticism against the whole approach that was condemned as ethnophilosophy. And ethnophilosophy would say a few things against this book and against African philosophy understood in the Templesian way. They would say, well, you cannot have collective philosophy. In order for a discourse to be philosophical, you have to have an individual taking responsibility for his thesis and signing his own name. If I write on behalf of all the Wolof about the moral philosophy of the Wolof, who am I to do that, to speak in the name of all the Wolof? And am I implying that all the Wolof people think in the same way? And they would add that this is very dangerous politically because you are postulating some unanimity and you are justifying all the dictatorships a la Mobutu, who would say that, well, African people are people of consensus, and that is the reason why I represent consensus, and I am going to rule them with executive orders. above all, the critique of ethnophilosophy also asserted that, in fact, in the context of orality, you could not have philosophy. which was a very important point to be made. It raised the question of the capacity of orality to carry something akin to critical approach. Is a culture which is transmitted orally capable of showing in that oral literature of that it carries and that it conveys and that it contains the capacity for self-reappraisal, self-criticism? That was a good question to be raised. I addressed that in my book, answering that actually orality can be critical. The other aspect which I deal with and which explained the importance of Timbuktu, Ahmed Baba, and what Madeleine reminded us, is that actually identifying Africa and orality is just a presupposition. It is not true that anything in the essence of African cultures would make them oral cultures. And in fact, you only say that if you ignore the history, the intellectual history of the continent. You only say that if you ignore that, for example, the fact that Islam has been present in West Africa and on the Swahili coast of Africa since the 11th century at least, meant also the adoption of the Arabic script, either the Arabic language or the Arabic script. And that many things were written. In particular, Islamization was not just about having a religion. It was also about receiving the so-called Islamic sciences or disciplines. And among them, among those disciplines, you had philosophy, Greek philosophy, Greek logic. So the whole picture of the history of philosophy as having followed what is called translatio studiorum, the transfer of knowledge from the Greek word. Usually we have our textbooks follow a very unilinear account of that. Philosophy was born in Greece and then was inherited by Rome and then went to Latin Christian Europe. And from there we have pre-modern, modern, contemporary, etc. So philosophy appears as the unique destination of Europe. You do that by just ignoring that the so-called translatio studiorum followed tours, made tours and detours. It did not just go from Athens to Rome. It also went from Athens to Nishapur, to Alexandria, to Baghdad. From there, it went to Cordoba in southern Spain. From there, it went to Kairouan in Fez. From there, it went to Timbuktu. So in the 16th century, in the 17th century, scholars from Timbuktu, in the heart of present-day Mali, was discussing Aristotle's logic or Plotinus' idea of the one, actually way, way before European presence there. So if you have to reconstruct philosophy in Africa, you have to also pay attention to the true intellectual history of the African continent, and that is something that I talk about also in this book. So basically, that is the history of this notion of African philosophy, put on the ground by starting with this foundational book, produced this important literature, then came the criticism against what was called ethnophilosophy, and now that's where my book starts. Now we are at the point where what we are doing is, in a more relaxed way, without throwing hyphens at each other. I say throwing hyphens at each other because people who were condemning temples and people who wrote after temples model were called ethno-philosophers, and those ethno-philosophers replied by calling their critiques Euro-philosophers, saying that they had a very Eurocentric understanding of what philosophy is. Now we are at the point where what African philosophers do is actually just start with the problems themselves. Instead of having the metaphilosophical discourse about what philosophy is, you don't need to do that. you just start with the problems themselves, and the problems are going to indicate what approaches are adequate to what they are. So what would be the main problems? I identified four, as Madeleine said. I thought that the philosophy of vital force is not to be just dismissed in the Caesarean way, and its its connection to African art should be explored. That is the first part of my book. I also considered that the anthropological approach of the notion of time needed to be examined. We all know this idea that African people have a CFA conception of time, meaning if you tell them that we are starting at 6:15, you are lucky if they are here at 7. Actually, I realized that this is very French as well, and I learned from Gloria that it is Italian also, so we are in good company. But once you have laughed about that, examining the philosophy of time is something that needs to be done, out of this atmosphere of stereotypes coming from ethnological approach a la Lévi-Bruhl. This is something I do also in another part of my book. And I look at the issue of orality, as I have mentioned. And in that, examining that, I have a chapter on the so-called manuscripts of Timbuktu. The attention of the world has been called to these manuscripts after terrorists actually went in northern Mali, occupied Timbuktu, and for a time, people were afraid that they would destroy those manuscripts. But Timbuktu is just a name and a symbol. Actually, these manuscripts, you find them everywhere. You even have more manuscripts in southern Mauritania, northern part of Senegal, than you have in Timbuktu. But Timbuktu has become the symbol for that tradition of written erudition. I have to use the tautology here, of written erudition in both West Africa and East Africa. Last, there are the political questions that Africans are facing. Madeleine mentioned, did you mention Gambia?
No.
Actually, I'm mixing up with something that Salim said earlier. It has been a long day, so I'm mixing up everything that I have heard, which was very interesting today. So the whole issue of human rights and socialism, so-called African socialism, is what constitutes the last part of my book. So I hope to have given you the context by retracing the history of the very phrase African philosophy, the context in which I have written this book. I did not want to go into the details because I want to respond afresh to the questions that are going to be posed by Gary. So. Okay.
Thank you, Bashir. So.
Thank you, Bashir. So I am going to try to bring out some of the. I think, in many ways, you are too modest about what you're doing. So I'm going to try to bring out some of the far-reaching implications, I think. So let me start by saying it's truly an honor to be here to discuss this important work, especially because I am no expert in African philosophy. I have no doubt that many others in this room are more qualified to offer learned commentary. But of course, I welcome any and every opportunity to continue a dialogue we've had over a long time. I think as both an interlocutor and as a writer, Bashir practices a characteristic mix of modesty and generosity and insight, and I wish there were more scholars like that. Among the many reasons I admire his work is this enduring commitment to explore connections across supposedly distant worlds, which we just heard a little bit about. Africa, the Maghreb, the Islamic world, and Europe. And thereby call into question many of the categories and frameworks through which we typically study those worlds and reify those distinctions. So I think he's pushing against that always. So too, The Ink of the Scholars, this wonderful book. What may appear to be a brief survey of debates within and about African philosophy is itself a powerful philosophical reflection and intervention, which I would say also has great significance beyond philosophy for African and Africana studies, postcolonial theory, intellectual history, literary studies, and political theory. So without pretending to do justice to the text, I would like to try to just sketch out the intellectual agenda that I think it opens up, and you may disagree with me, we'll put a bunch on the table. So Bashir's starting point, as he mentioned, is the question of African philosophy, at stake in which has always been deeper questions about the universality of rationality and whether humanity is singular or multiple. Western philosophy and discourses about it, as Bashir notes at the beginning of his book, have always been bound up with processes of racialization, social exclusion, and colonial subjection. And in response, as we just heard, and understandably, many African intellectuals developed a forceful critique of philosophy itself as fundamentally Western, an instrument of domination, and necessarily foreign to Africans, such that Africans who do philosophy are alienating and betraying themselves, acting in bad faith, even complicit with Eurocentrism. But such positions, Bashir tells us in the book, only affirm Heidegger's racist claim that Greek and German are the only true languages of philosophy. He reminds us that 19th century Europeans themselves invented this idea of the fundamental Europeanness of philosophy, and we should not unwittingly agree with them. Thus, as he just outlined, this debate over ethnophilosophy. Some scholars sought a distinctive African philosophy in forms of everyday life, in unreflective ways of being, relating, and knowing, as expressed in cultural practices, worldviews, and language use. Others, like Untongi, who you just cited, argued that philosophy and cultural worldviews were antithetical, since philosophy, by definition, must be self-aware and self-critical, not just a way of seeing and knowing, but a written and critical meta-discourse on seeing and knowing. So on the one hand, Bashir agrees. He writes that, quote, an ethnic worldview carried by every element of the group and naturally expressed in its language, gestures, judgments, postures, etc., and serving as thought makes little sense. He's clear about that. But on the other hand, he recognizes the philosophical insights and implications embedded and embodied in certain African forms of life, as he was just telling us. Thus, the idea of a dynamic ontology of vital forces, of being as a force that happens, enabling a fullness of life and fervor to exist. Through this, Bashir also links African ontology to European vitalism. So he takes seriously the project of Bantu philosophy. And even recovering that text, I think, is an extraordinary operation that you perform in this book, given how contentious it's been. So the question of African philosophy automatically raises a whole set of questions about philosophy itself in relation to historical contexts, cultural logics, linguistic structures, written texts, academic disciplines, critical rationality, and everyday life or embodiment, as well as the universality or generality or translatability of reason, concepts, truth, wisdom, etc. I am simplifying the complex debates that Bashir maps so eloquently in the book, but I want to underscore that he maps them in ways that I think displace the false oppositions, sterile debates, and patterned impasses that so often overdetermine discussions about African philosophy and knowledge. Bashir has little patience for currents of Nietzschean perspectivism, ethnological relativism, and African linguistic nativism that posit the existence of multiple humanities with irreconcilable and mutually intelligible forms of thought. He writes, quote, the differentialist posture, which betrays the ethnographer's initial conviction that he is dealing with an other way of being that is so foreign, does nothing but invent what it is looking for. He is sympathetic to Huntongji's argument that African philosophy is simply the totality of philosophical texts written by philosophers who happen to be Africans. Yet, and he's always balancing throughout this in that generous and thoughtful and careful way, he also has a broad understanding of what counts as philosophy. He concurs that philosophy needs to open itself to thought from elsewhere, that it is time to philosophize in African languages, and that such work does not have to assume a textual form. Bachir thus cuts through these debates, the debates he just outlined, by treating philosophy as a verb, by shifting from philosophy as a body of knowledge to philosophy as a living, changing, open-ended practice. He constantly talks about philosophizing in Africa, in African languages. Philosophe en Afrique could be the title of the book, I think, and as it was a title of an edited volume, I think you did. But that, in a way, this book is about philosophizing in Africa. In response to ethno-relativist arguments like Alexis Kagame's, Bachir demonstrates that there is no intrinsic relationship between linguistic structures and forms of thinking, nor between essentially abstract and essentially concrete languages, one of the debates that has haunted the question of African philosophy. In response to high philosophical critiques of implicit or lived philosophies, Bachir demonstrates that oral traditions are not simply static repositories of inherited knowledge, compendia of rules, or mechanical expressions of cultural logics, but are always already intertextual. They are self-critical meta-commentaries on social norms and the very idea of tradition. These traditions are always commenting on the idea of tradition, he suggests. And to defenders of an essential African orality who claim only to be transcribing traditional knowledge so it can be preserved, he demonstrates that they too are writing philosophy. And I'm going to give you a long quote here of one of my favorite moments in the book that I think crystallize a lot of his argument and his way of thinking. Bachir writes, quote, and this is about African writers who claim only to be transcribing oral knowledge and not be doing philosophy. He says, it is important to insist on a point which these writers speak of infinitely less than they demonstrate in their texts, the pleasure they take in writing. Indeed, it is with pleasure that oratory is welcomed into writing, that the spoken word is reprised, extended, transformed, becomes imprinted with another rhythm. It is not the thought of loss or death that is the principle of this reprise, but that of lift, of the power to fabulate. To see things this way means understanding that it is time to think about the delight of writing celebrated naturally by writers in their practice. Even those who assert the opposite, those who identify with an orality whose nostalgic heirs they claim to be, or who declare their regret at having to write in a language they would like to pretend is still foreign to them, while every letter they trace presents us with their greatest possible declaration of love. He thus concludes, it is time to put an end to the discourse about a griot whose speech would always be found crouched somewhere underneath the writers. Just beautiful passages. He's not dismissing orality here either. I hope that's clear. Bachir also challenges claims about the fundamental orality of African society, as he just suggested, by pointing to a long erudite tradition of textual study and scholarship in sub-Saharan Africa, in places like Djenné and Timbuktu, of philosophizing in both Arabic and African languages like Hausa and Fufulde. To those who insist on the essential foreignness of philosophy to Africa, he cites this long history of engagement with Islamic philosophical, theological, juridical, and philological texts. He reminds us that sub-Saharan Africans were aware of Plato and Aristotle and debates about logic, as he said, long before the arrival of European colonizers. Philosophy in Africa, he explains, has always been marked by trans-regional encounters and detours, linking Africans to the Maghreb, the Islamic world, and later to Europe, along which people, texts, concepts, and debates circulated. And this hasn't stopped, as we see that embodied in you right here. So in short, I'm going to collect this up. Bachir seems to be asking about how to challenge philosophy's racist and Eurocentric heritage without renouncing it as a truth-seeking practice, and how to pluralize philosophy without abandoning it for ethnology. He seems to be telling us, yes, we absolutely need to philosophize in African language, in African languages. And yes, Africans should not hesitate to philosophize in non-African languages. That philosophy is neither abstractly universal nor the mechanical expression of an ethnic worldview. Philosophical knowledge and insights are always rooted, situated, worldly, and heterogeneous, but their significance may also always transcend the cultural context in which they are immediately produced. This position, which we might call concrete universalism, follows from Bashir's important and original insights on translation, which I would suggest are at the very center of his philosophical project and contribution. You didn't say much about translation, so I'm going to say a couple of things and then finish. So, and this is really at the heart of the book, and it's so important. It's really exciting and interesting. He's doing something quite original. So Bashir speaks of the ethical aim and orientation of translation. Citing Antoine Berman, he contrasts reductive, appropriative, and ethnocentric forms of translation to translation as a decentering practice of what Bashir calls putting in touch. He calls it translation as opening, as dialogue, and métissage. Citing Barbara Cassin, Bashir reminds us that translation is not a matter of giving, quote, equivalents of the same concept in different languages, but of deterritorializing ways of speaking that make us aware of what Arendt called the faltering equivocity of the world. Referring to the project of African socialism, he thus insists that there is no model. Quote, there, quote, only translations exist without a text that could be claimed as the original one written in a sacred language. This is also the perspective from which we should read his wonderful formulation. He says, translation is treason? Certainly, but this betrayal is the only true fidelity, something you might say more about. I take it to mean that meaning and illumination, the meaning and illumination treasured by philosophy reside precisely in that gap in practice. So translation is the starting point, not the kind of, the problems of translation is the starting point, not the punchline of this gap between languages and cultures. These reflections on philosophy and translation, or I might suggest or ask you, do you mean philosophy as translation, proceed from two crucial starting points. On the one hand, he cites Bergson's claim that, quote, nothing another human does is foreign to me. On the other, he cites Goethe's claim that, quote, we know nothing of our own language if we do not know any other. So translation at the very heart of philosophy. In this spirit, Bashir follows the Ghanaian thinker Kwasi Wiredu's call to, quote, put philosophical questions connected to the notion of truth to the test of translation. It's quite a, as this whole book, it's an economical formulation that ramifies. For quote, philosophical, he's continuing, he says, philosophical questions have a way of becoming in some way clarified once they are posed simultaneously in English and Akan. So note, he regards this process of putting in touch as the means by which philosophical questions may be what he calls universally posed. This is not a relative, it is a decentralizing and pluralizing operation, but not a relativist position. And that's the crucial thing I think he's doing. In this way, he displaces the false opposition between abstract universalist philosophies and concrete particular worldviews. He writes, quote, this is him again, quote, the majority of African philosophers believe the moment has come to philosophize in African languages. This task can be thought of as the will to produce an other philosophy which would keep us close to each language's way of speaking. This is Kagame's route. But it can also be thought of as a means of, and listen, thinking philosophically in translation and in crossing perspectives. There is every reason to believe this is the root of the future, end quote. And this is what he's doing. This call to think philosophically in translation seems to be at the very heart of Bashir's intervention. It is not only a vision for the future of African philosophy, but a claim about philosophy as such, and perhaps a deeper claim about thinking and writing more generally, something else I would ask. So this is the method and orientation that allows Bachir to argue, quote, if the Bantu speak of philosophy of life, which therefore is theirs and equally Africa's, it is also more generally universally human. In this way, he recounts how Temple's Bantu philosophy, quote, ended up freeing itself from its specific and exclusive incarnation in a local view of the world to become a sort of universal monadology, where a truly first philosophy expresses itself, where being force is not yet frozen into substance. His method thus invites us to attend to the specificity of African thought without reducing it to its scene of production and evacuating it of its philosophical significance. He warns against treating African thought merely as an ethnographic artifact. So I can't resist another nice quote. Quote, we will treat it, by which he means we should treat it, let's treat it, as if it is born under the gaze that gives it life, the reader's gaze. Careful not to pin it like a dead butterfly upon a card, together with the inventory of ethnographic details, which certainly provide its history, but which can hardly explain its presence, its existence outside of its own time, since it no more belongs to the one in which it is regarded outside of time. This is also the method that allows him to suggest that attention to African reflections on time do not simply prove the existence of a specifically African conception of time, but reveal a deep philosophical insight about time itself. Thus, his attempts throughout this very short book to place African literature, religion, and art in dialogue with a wide range of African philosophers, as well as the philosophical reflections of people like Bergson, Wittgenstein, and Gaston Berger. For these reasons, I would identify Bachir's work as a major and welcome example of what elsewhere I have called the task of deprovincializing African thought and decolonizing intellectual history. I would therefore suggest that The Ink of Scholars is not only a contribution to African philosophy, which it certainly is, but a work that has far-reaching implications for the human sciences. We can think here of the debates many of us are involved in post-colonial theory, about provincializing Europe, about decolonial knowledge, about Talal Asad's very interesting writings about discursive and embodied traditions. And Bachir comes at these from a slightly different angle that both converge and also call into question some of the assumptions of those conventional ways or recent ways of thinking. Or we can think about the debates within literary and philosophical studies about translation, the untranslatable, the Cassin's Dictionary of Untranslatables, Emily Apter's writings, so many political questions about epistemology in the human sciences now seem to be revolving around this question of translation, which is at the very heart of his book. It certainly also has implications for Black studies and debates about the Black radical tradition and Africana thought as essentially non-Western, essentially African, what it means to be African or Africana. I think you both take that rooted, lived, specific, very distinctive those distinctive forms of thought that have to be grasped on their own terms seriously, and also call into question any and all attempts to kind of a priori limit, reduce, and categorically separate these forms of thought. So I think this is the future of critical thinking from the South and about the South. So I'll stop there.
Thank you, Gary, for bringing out so much of the importance of the different interventions, the stakes that are in this book, and also for reading passages, because as you said several times, it's really beautifully written, and the translation is really well done as well, speaking of translations.
Yeah, great. Bachir,
I imagine that you would like to add some things and respond and develop some points in response to what Gary has said, and then we can open up after that.
Well, thank you, and thank you so much, Gary. Everybody would agree that nobody could dream of a better reader than you, and thank you for the work you've done here. I will just take one point here and there and add a few things. First of all, you are right that this turned out to be an intervention. Actually, what explains the format of this text, why it was not supposed to be a very long text, is that I was asked by the executive secretary of CODESRIA to write a book on the state of the matter of African philosophy. And I hesitated for years. I just did not do it. He was insisting. And I found out that the reason why I could not do it is that just looking at the literature and saying this is the literature about it is not something I could do. It turned out to become something very personal, my own intervention in that field, my own way of responding to that. The kid I was who doing his aggregation was looking for reasons to just go with working on Bull, Leibniz, Frege, and just pretending that he might not be even from the African continent. So it turned out to be that kind of personal thing. And I found out writing it that I had things to say also about, for example, rationality and universality. I am deeply, profoundly a universalist person. I do not believe in relativism. I do think that universal is complicated. I think with Merleau-Ponty that we cannot have Bandung, actually 1955, this what Levinas called the eruption of the Afro-Asian masses on into the scene of history has questioned the traditional notion of universality. In the language of Merleau-Ponty, that questioning meant, was translated this way. Merleau-Ponty says that after colonialism, after Bandung, one cannot have anymore what he called a universel de surplomb in French, an overarching universal, a universal that would come from above for the verticality of cultures that decided that they were the logos, that they were the language of the universal, and that everything else should be oriented towards them. And he said that what we have, the task now, is to explore what he called a horizontal or lateral universal, a universal of encounter, a universal of negotiation. And I believe that the name of that universal is translation. As Ngugi wa Thiong'o famously said, the language of languages is translation. And so the gesture of Ngugi wa Thiong'o writing in Kikuyu, but at the same time having this praise for translation, I believe is the right way of responding to the new challenge of going towards a truly universal universal, that is the expression of Immanuel Wallenstein, and so not renounce the universal, but complicate it. That's what I try to do with others who think along those lines. You have mentioned Barbara Cassin, Emily Apter. I have joined them in the project, the huge project of the untranslatables, in its English incarnation, Anglo-American incarnation, and in the next stage that we are thinking about, Ms. Barbara Cassin. So yes, translation is truly at the heart of what I am.
Are you saying the same thing as them? Are you saying the same? Is your position the same?
No, because
doesn't seem to be.
Barbara is more relativist than I am. She's a militant for something she calls consequent relativism, and I. This is my kind of Althusserian thing. You cannot just escape who you were if you have been once an Althusserian. I keep this idea that we have to inscribe everything on some kind of horizon of universality, and that is a difference that we what we have. But what we share is still the notion that going towards the universal, you have to do that from the plurality of languages. Actually, you cannot think about the universal if you do not start with deconstructing this identification of certain languages and certain cultures with the logos itself. The Heideggerian national ontologism that you mentioned that made him say that Greek is the natural language of philosophy, and now that Greek is a dead language, the best avatar of it is German. So against that, I like to look at languages in their plurality and say, like my friends Barbara, Emily, etc., that we always speak a language which is one among others. This is something that philosophers do not easily realize. When they speak a language, they happen to be writing in English, they happen to be writing in French, but they do think that they are speaking the language of the logos itself. So when they say that the most serious problem in the world is the problem of being, they do not pay attention to the fact that the only reason why you can have such a formulation is that you are speaking a language in which when you add ing to the verb, you get the substantive being. And not all languages function that way. This is the reason why I believe that one has to be able to navigate between languages, thinking between languages, or thinking not between, because between languages is a void. There is nothing between languages. But what, as I say in French, penser de langue à langue, thinking from language to language, translating. The idea that the philosopher is a translator. If you have the good fortune of being able to think and write in many different languages, it is worth trying to do what Kwasi Wiredu did, which is put philosophical problems to the test of translation and see what happens. If what he did with Tarski's definition of the truth, actually translating it into Akan, saying that, well, the very notion that the definition of truth is that something is the case if and only if the state of affairs corresponds to what it is actually affirming, try to translate that in languages where you cannot have that kind of same formulation. It will teach you something about the problem itself, the definition given by Tarski, the language in which Tarski was writing, and the language in which you have been translating it. So you enrich the problem. You do not deny its universality, but you enrich that universality, and that is what I try to call the way of complicating the universal. And the way of doing that is through translation. I do believe in the ethics of translation. Translation as a way of putting in touch languages. And I'm so happy that right now I'm co-teaching a seminar with Peter Connor on translation, and we are enjoying it very much. I hope our students are enjoying it as much as we do. Those are the things on which I wanted to react. Now about, yes, the vital force, or the force of living as I call it, where I do not agree with Temples is to make it the kind of collective philosophy of the Bantu people. Mm. The Bantu people think along the lines of vital force. But the very system he has with those postulates is very interesting philosophically. First of all, we can put it at work in reading African art, for one thing, because philosophical concepts are useful if they give you the key to sort of explain something. And in this case, it is a very good tool to deal with African aesthetics. At the same time, there is nothing specifically African in it. As I say, I'm not a relativist, I'm not a separatist. So this idea of having a specific Western Chang, I don't really agree with that. One could say that the series of postulates given by Temples actually could be translated very easily in the language of Spinoza's ethics. The whole conatus could be translated into those terms. Or I could also do that, you quoted that passage, as Leibniz monadology as well. So there is nothing specific in it, and something I liked in temples, the reason why I am more charitable, I would say, to temples than Paul-Léon Tanguy, who is a friend and a mentor of mine, is that I paid attention to the correspondence of temples, which is very interesting. And Temple says in his correspondence, at first I was fascinated by this dynamic ontology of the force, and I thought, well, this is the way in which I'm going to talk to the Bantus to convert them to Christianity. I'm going to tell them that actually Christ himself has said at one point, I am life, and I give life in abundance to people who follow me. This is the gospel. And then he said, well, in doing that, what I realized, that I was actually connecting to the true meaning, to the true philosophy of the gospel, and I was reconnecting to its significance beyond the Aristotelian and Thomistic petrification of it in the language of a subject and predicates. I was retrieving, he said, the first significance of logos before it was translated into Latin as ratio. Ratio is a kind of petrification of logos, and in studying the Bantus, he said, I retrieved the first meaning of logos, what Senghor called the humid and vibratory meaning of logos. So the way in which temples who came to convert the Bantu by studying what is specific about their way of seeing the word and finding out that that was not specific at all, it was so universal that this was the language of his own religion, and being converted back to his own religion via the Bantus, I loved that complication of the universal. Yeah. Who would not? Yeah. This is an example of complication of the universal that I liked very much. So thank you again for all your remarks.
Wonderful. So I think maybe we should open things up for a more more general conversation. So I think there's a microphone to pass around. So if you would like to ask a question, please raise your hand and then wait for the microphone to arrive. Yes.
Thank you so much for this fascinating discussion. I really like the way Gary Wilder framed the whole discussion and link your work with Kagame, because we talked about this before, and he obviously was a big influence in your own writing. My question, you know, within the context of universality, I'm trying to understand what role Bantu or maybe other African languages could have had in creating more progressive African societies. You know, if within the context of universality or even post-colonialism, what could have happened if our own African languages had been valued more than they actually were?
I think that's an excellent question, and thank you for that. And I do believe that it would have advanced things greatly. I don't say that just vaguely like that. Let me use an example, which is now a controversial example, but which is still valid. The way in which Ubuntu, the concept of Ubuntu, has been put to work in South Africa is something very important. Actually, when Desmond Tutu and Nelson Mandela were confronted with this very question of building a new nation out of the Commission on Truth and Reconciliation, at the same time acknowledging the crimes of apartheid, but acknowledging them in order to go beyond, no matter how painful it was, the way in which they were able to put at work a concept in the language of South Africa, coming with this word, which is actually a word that you would find in almost all Bantu languages, because it is built on the same root as the word Bantu itself, which characterizes both languages. This idea of being human together, building together our humanness. The way in which they were able to use that and to turn this Bantu word into a concept that would be able to operate in the kind of transitional justice that they were looking for, I think would be a response to your question. That is what I have in mind when I say that it is necessary for the philosophers to be a translator, to live from language to language, and at the same time to make sure that African languages are not left behind, that they are not going to be just languages for private interaction, but they are going to be also languages of philosophy, of literary creation, and so on and so forth. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much. That was fascinating. About this, about the question of language and translation, I guess that, what do you think about the fact that historically there's been this hierarchy of power between languages, and I mean, to what extent have languages internalized those hierarchies? And so within each languages themselves, there is some sort of limits, right? That reflect those hierarchies, and how even through translation and moving from languages, the philosopher can escape those historical... Is that clear?
It is clear. Okay. It is clear, and I thank you for that question, because you have put your finger on the paradox of translation. When you praise translation the way I do, and actually the most recent book by Barbara Cassin is called precisely that, In Praise of Translation, Éloge de la Traduction, you could seem to be naive to believe in this idea that we, thanks to translation, we are going to have this kind of universal transparency of everybody to everybody else, that we would be, you know, singing the kumbaya and understanding each other, and that Alta Vista is going to be the promised land. It's not true, and you have to acknowledge that behind translation there is domination, that languages are not equal. So certain languages, obviously, in the field of translation, when you do now the sociology of translation, as Pascal Casanova did in her book La Langue Mondiale, and the subtitle is Traduction et Domination, you have domination in translation when you look at what is being translated and so on and so forth. One of my favorite examples, I am often invited by publishing houses to give them my advice about a book originally written in French and to be published in English. One question I always have to answer is, hasn't that book already found its readers in French? In other words, why would we translate it in English? Isn't it true that everybody who would be interested in it already speaks French? Only French speakers would be interested in it. This is a very plain way of, you know, presupposing the universality of the English language, and you are asking yourself whether the particularity of the tribe speaking French could actually be in there, which is something very interesting for the Senegalese that I am, to look at the French being treated as this kind of particular tribe by the truly dominant language is something very interesting too. But that is the reality of the relationship between languages. Now, the paradox is that the best answer to the domination of languages still is translation. Although the very activity of translation, when you look at it in a sociology a la Pierre Bourdieu, shows that this field, to use the language of Bourdieu, is a field of domination, at the same time, it is through translation that you create reciprocity. So in other words, this idea that the lateral universal, the horizontal universal, is going to be realized by translation remains true ethically, in spite of the truth that economically and sociologically you have this relationship of hierarchy and domination between languages. So thank you for your...
Hello, Bashir.
Hi.
His question made me think of something. I remember being in school, I would say in first grade, and my native language is Wolof, and the teacher was teaching in French. and I didn't understand anything. And his question asking what African society could have been if they had their own languages. In Senegal, for instance, you learn in French, and I didn't understand anything. And for that reason, I was a so-called bad student. And I think about all the people who end up dropping out of school because they are taught in a language that is not their language. And you don't see it in this country. They speak English, that's the language that they speak. So can you talk about that, the impact, and maybe to come back to this question, what these African society could have been if the citizens of those countries were taught in their own languages?
Sure, sure. And this is a very important problem. As you know, I'm so happy to see you here. And we have been dealing with that question for a long time in Senegal. And everybody is convinced that you have to have a coherent policy of languages. Having the child start school in the language that is the language that she speaks at home, in some kind of continuity with her experience of learning from her parents in the first language, is very important. Many experiences have been already conducted showing that kids who are taught first in their own language, Wolof, Jola, Pular, etc., and then who are taught in French, catch up very quickly. And so the whole problem is to generalize that. I understand that the situations are very different from an African country to another African country. In Senegal, we have, when you look at it, actually, we have very few languages. We have Wolof that everybody speaks, unless you start deciding that everybody speaks it, and then you will find out that only 40% of people speak it, which is already a problem. But as long as you say nothing, everybody speaks Wolof. So it is different from a country like Cameroon, where you have many different tiny languages. So or Cote d'Ivoire, even if people speak Jula, deciding on a language where you do not have the lingua franca. So the only answer is you have to be pluralist. I mean, you do not want to favor the imperialism of any given language. No matter how small a language is always a face of the human adventure. So every single language is worth being developed. So, but it means the complications of how you are going to conduct your policy, the linguistic policy. But it is true, you're absolutely right, that our systems of education have to integrate the African languages. They have to integrate. I was invited, as you know, a few years ago by the president, the current president of Senegal, to conduct, to be the head of a commission reflecting on the reform of higher education. This was about higher education, not really elementary schools. But one of the recommendations we made in that team was to think of a linguistic policy. If you think of a linguistic policy now, according to what I'm thinking and saying and the quotes from my work that Gary has read, I believe that French or English or Portuguese are what I call languages of Africa. I don't call them African languages, but they are languages of Africa. Obviously, if someone hears me speak French and hear me pretend that French is foreign to me, I would be ridiculous saying that. I'm obviously 100% French, if being French means speaking French. At the same time, I'm 100% Wolof. Now I'm close to 98% English, I guess, if you are generous enough with me. So, yes, that is how things should be thought of in connection with the system of education. But we cannot afford to have that many dropouts because the kids are not speaking, the language of the school is not the language that they have at home. So at a very early age, you discourage certain kids just because they do not grasp the règle du participe passé. And well, if they were taught elements of geometry and mathematics and arithmetics in Wolof, and then afterwards learn it in French or in English, it would have been much better, I agree with you.
So could we have one last question, because there are some people who've had their hands up for a while. Okay. Apparently, no, we cannot, which is a shame, because there are a lot of hands still up. Right, but the good news is that we can continue more informally at a reception. So if you did have your hand up and you have a question, and I know I have several as well, so I feel your pain, then we can ask those questions then. But for now, I really want to thank Bachir for speaking so eloquently about his eloquent book, and to thank Gary for bringing out some of its power, some of its strengths. So it's really been a very rich discussion, covering, touching on so many vital issues. So thank you.